Welcome to Semantic Web Technologies, Lecture 1, The Web of Data, Part 5, The Vision of the Semantic Web. In the last part of the lecture, we have talked about the problems that arise because of the lack of semantic information within the web. And now, we want to take a look at how the semantic web can help in this situation. So first we have to think about what does the semantic web mean. And the semantic web is a term that came up in the end of the 90s, and it was proposed by Sir Tim Berners-Lee, who is also the inventor, in quotation marks, of the World Wide Web. And he said already in 1998 that the web originally was designed as an information space with a goal that it should be useful not only for human-human communication, but also that machines would be able to participate and help. And this, of course, would only be possible if the content of the information can be read and interpreted correctly. It means that it can be understood by machines. Only then, of course, machines can participate and help. And originally, the way to deduce the meaning of the information was done by natural language processing. And of course, it's still done today. For example, in the huge search engines that you know, in Google, Bing, or other search engines, of course, there are natural language processing technologies, and they try to extract the meaning of the information. But on the other hand, just think about what would be possible if the meaning of the information would not be extracted from the implicit information within natural language, which is a rather error-prone process. But on the other hand, of course, you could beforehand explicitly state what the information given really means. And this is the way that the semantic web goes. It means the information content of the natural language on the web will be explicitly annotated with semantic metadata. And this semantic metadata encodes the meaning, it's the semantics, of the content. And this can be read and interpreted by machines correctly. So you have these two ways. First, automatic information extraction via natural language processing. It's the way it's done today in the search engines. And the other thing is, besides encoding information within natural language, you could give additional semantic information in an explicit way so that the error-prone process of extracting the meaning via natural language processing would be supported by already given explicitly stated semantic annotation. So be prepared. The semantic web really contains explicit semantics. And thus, it's pretty much easier to understand the content and to get rid of the four problems that we have identified beforehand in the last part of the lecture. But what does it mean to represent information correctly? So let's step back and let's take a look at a website. I have chosen here a website a few years old from the World Cup in 2010, so these occurrences are not so present in our everyday or today's thinking, so it's difficult to understand the content. So here you have the headline, "Why SnapMeFab?" And the problem is, what does it mean? Who is telling what? And you have some pictures here. Of course, it's related somehow to soccer playing or football playing. And then you have the term James getting frustrated on the bench. So this and the information that it's related to the World Cup 2010 might help you to understand what is really told here. So what the machine usually does is, first, of course, we want to look at who is somehow present or about whom is talked in that sentence. So we extract the text, "Why SnapMeFab?" and we try to guess what is meant with this term fab. And there you have several possibilities because the sense of this term is not unique. So you have to solve this disambiguation problem. And this disambiguation problem first tries to generate all possible candidates what can be meant by the term fab. Fab, for example, is a detergent. Does it make sense in that context? Or on the other hand, FAB is also the Film Advisory Board. Does this make sense? Maybe a person is meant, so for example, Fab Melo, a Brazilian basketball player, or for example, Fabrizio Moretti, who is the drummer of the band The Strokes. In the end, somehow, you might come up with Fabio Capello because he is the manager of the UK national football team in 2010. So maybe when you are familiar with the pictures that are shown here, you will have identified here Fabio Capello, who is the manager of the UK football team. Okay, so when you have the mapping from the term FAB to the so-called semantic entity Fabio Capello, you need more information about Fabio Capello. So what is it, Fabio Capello? It's a soccer manager. So Fabio Capello belongs to the Glass Soccer Manager, and the soccer manager, of course, is a person. So the Glass Soccer Manager is a subclass of the Glass Person. But what is a soccer manager and what is a person? So, okay, again, the meaning here is expressed with the help of appropriate knowledge. This knowledge representation is given in terms of ontologies, and it means that we have here an entity, Fabio Capello, and the entity is member of a given class. And of course, we have to describe the class to make clear what does the class mean. So for example, we can say soccer manager is a subclass or is part of the class person. It means a soccer manager, of course, is a person. On the other hand, we can also denote more information. For example, we can say all persons must have some birthplace. And in the end, of course, also Fabio Capello has a birthplace. The birthplace is San Canzian, and we can deduce it that San Canzian is a place. Furthermore, we can also assume that every person has a birth date. And in the same way, then, Fabio Capello has a birth date. And from the fact that Fabio Capello has a birth date, we can deduce that this instance, it means June 18, 1946, is a date. So what you see here, information or knowledge, is given first by properties that simple individuals or instances of class members have, as well as by relations of different classes. So this is the way how information or knowledge is represented, and we will come back to that in detail later. But now we can define what the semantic web is. So the semantic web is nothing else than an extension of the current web, in which information is given a well-defined meaning in the form of semantic annotations, better enabling then computers and people to work in cooperation. By that, it means the meaning of information is made explicit with the help of formal, in this sense, structured and standardized knowledge representation, which are ontologies. And now it's possible to process the meaning of information in an automated way and to relate and integrate previously heterogeneous different data and, in the end, to deduce implicit and not evident information from existing information, and also to do this in an automated way. So the semantic web is nothing else but a global database that contains a universal network of semantic propositions and assertions. And technologically, the semantic web builds up a stack like you see here, and you see the technology starts on the button, on the web, and there knowledge representation, knowledge exchange, languages build up one over the other. We have here downstairs in the web, for example, identification mechanisms like URI. We have access mechanisms like HTTP. We have coding mechanisms like Unicode and also basic authorization that is implemented in the web layer. Then we have an information exchange layer where we have encoding, for example, as XML or Turtle or RDFA and microformats. So we get semantic information into web pages, into HTML. And above that, we have the possibility to say, what is a fact? So we do this with the resource description framework. And these facts that can be exchanged, and they can be queried on the other hand. And based on the top of these facts, we also must state what is the world and how does the things in the world, the classes and concepts, relate to each other. So we have to build models, and we can do this with ontology representation languages, for example, with OWL, which is the web ontology language, RDFS, which is the RDF schema language, or with simple ontologies like SCoS. And moreover, we can apply logic to make logical deductions and to get more and new knowledge out of already existing knowledge. But how to do that, we can come back to that in the next part when we deal with part 2 of the vision of the semantic web.